Okay. Good evening, everyone. My name is Jitendra Chawla, and on behalf of CFS Society India, I welcome you all to today's webinar titled Investing Under Uncertainty. Well, these are unprecedented times. The coronavirus pandemic has hit the world hard. As they say, we are in the midst of a perfect storm. There's so many moving parts to this thing, the pandemic itself and its effects. The economic contraction, which is already wreaking havoc on economies and people, and oil price collapse, government and central banks' responses to all this, investors' reaction, their second, third, maybe fourth order effects. It's just mind-boggling. We usually deal with these situations by looking into the past for guidance, but the problem is that we have never seen or experienced before what's happening in the world today. Even experienced investors are finding it difficult to grasp the situation that is unfolding before us. Charlie Munger says this thing is different. Nobody knows what's going to happen. Howard Marks in his latest memo says nobody's experienced something like this before, and hence nobody can say how it's going to turn out. At best, most economists and investors are guessing. We can study wars, recessions, pandemic, depressions, past, as much as we want, but this is nothing like the past. So I have no doubt the fact, and I'm using these cliched words, but they can't be more true than now, it is different this time. This is uncertainty of a different kind, a different level altogether. So in these uncertain times, we have with us someone who's a very deep thinker and a very versatile investor, a young wizard of the Lal Street. We have with us Mr. Kuntal Shah. Kuntal is a member of the board of management at the Flame University. Flame was founded with the concept of liberal education as its cornerstone. Kuntal has an opportunistic inclination towards value-oriented and risk-controlled approach to investment. He has been an extremely successful investor over the past two decades, and his investing success has come from exploiting the inefficiencies inherent in the market. Kuntal will share with us what his thoughts are regarding the current situation, how he's analyzing where we are and all the different scenarios of where we might be headed. He's going to zoom out and give us the big picture on global macro and market valuations and what has led us to the current state of the world. The idea is to understand how we can build a framework to analyze where we are, what's happening, and what actions we can take as investors. We will have a presentation followed by a Q&A from participants who can submit their questions through the option on the screen. I will request all participants to keep on submitting their questions right from the beginning and not wait till the presentation to end. So Kuntal Bhai, over to you.
Thank you, Jitendra. I hope I'm audible, and I hope I find you all in great health while you are quarantined. Just a few housekeeping announcements. This presentation is going to be shared, so I think I request you to not spend too much time on analyzing the empirical data points which are given in these slides, and not focus there, but try to focus on implication and connecting the dots, which is going to be discussed with you on the voiceover. This is an era of unprecedented uncertainties, and the whole presentation is going to bring about uncertainties which prevail from the vantage point and perspective of different participants in the business and investing ecosystem. I would like to thank the students at Flame University and staff at Oakland Capital, which have helped me to prepare this presentation. The presentation is structured in four parts. First, I'm going to discuss about the pre-COVID conditions which prevailed, moving on to the COVID arrival of COVID and the moving parts which result out of the situation. Uppermost question in all of our mind is the comparison with the previous precedent of similar type. So going to spend some time on discussing the events of the bygone era, and then move on to the most important question, burning question in our mind, which is portfolio construction in an post-COVID world. If you recollect, pre-COVID, global economy also was slowing down, and it was reflected in falling commodity prices, and the fragility in the financial system was coming to the fore. And there was high-end riskiness in terms of loose monetary policies combined with low interest rates. As seen from this slide, even before we entered into this crisis, the global debt to GDP and the balance sheets of central bankers were overstretched relative to all previous crises which we are familiar of. So to this extent, as Leo Tolstoy has suggested, that all happy families are alike, but each unhappy family is unhappy in its own way. So while there are glaring similarities between the current episode and the previous episodes, the two moot point which I want to continuously stress is that we are entering this crisis with the, one of the highest GDP to debt ratios and high leverage present across all participants, and the interest rate which are almost bordering on the floor level. Debt is borrowing from future, and too much can leave future drive and serve as a drag on future returns. Also, anemic growth is an outcome due to expansion of credit. And if you recall, in last 10 years post GFC, more and more debt has produced less and less GDP growth. What happens next is anybody's guess. It's not just the floor interest rates. Many of the safe risk-free interest rates in Eurozone especially are already yielding negative rates. Just to put this thing in context, this is one of the lowest interest rate environment in last 5,000 years. This era of low inflation, high debt, and low cost of debt is almost a Goldilocks scenario. And there are pervasive market incentive in keeping this interest long, interest rates low, even 12 years after the GFC has passed through, which has resulted in low inflation and high asset price. Actually, every time the central bankers tried weaning away the market from low interest rate junk food diet, markets reacted terribly and central bankers caved in. And one of the prime examples was that in December 2018, where market suddenly just fell off the charts and central bank had to unwind the stated path of returning the interest rate to normalcy. Now, why do these negative rates happen? Because the regulators have ensured that there are price insensitive buyers in many categories because of the regulations which require them to have asset liability matching and as well also solvency related regulations. Central bankers have almost made certain that prudent investing is not possible in these circumstances, and I'm going to explain this in much detail in slides going ahead. But just to set the context, pre-COVID, we had one of the strongest historical bull run where the index S&P 500 gave 11% more return than the nominal GDP growth in the USA. This was unprecedented for such a long period of time. Second observation is when I plot the crisis map on a logarithmic scale, one thing is very clear that in earlier part of the history, the crisis used to occur less frequently and they used to last for a longer duration, which you can see by the length of the duration of green line on the left-hand side of the chart. But as we move towards the recent years, the frequency of the crisis and the booms are increasing, but the duration of them is decreasing fairly because of the aggressive countervailing stance taken by monetary authorities and central bankers. This context needs to be borne in mind when we are comparing the past episodes with the current one. Also, the valuation at which we enter this crisis matter a lot, because future returns are a function of current prices paid. And in fact, I would stick out my limb to say that the central bankers have become serial bubble blowers, because they would rather have high asset prices and kick the can down the road. Just to give you the empirical evidence supporting this, if you see the zone in green, which represents the value change valuation change as one of the most prime source for asset price inflation during the current year. So for the period ending March 19 to December 2019, if you see the valuation changes resulting from extraordinarily low interest rate prevalent in Eurozone, Japan, and USA have been a significant driver of increase in the asset prices, both bonds as well as equities. And this is the condition with which we have entered into a serious health pandemic. Easy money and low interest rates are necessary conditions for bubbles. They are not the sufficient, but usually all the bubbles are associated with these two criteria in place, in addition of things like catalyst and new things which get imagination of investing population. Also, when you look at the current high valuations across all the major markets, the one thing which is very clear is they are very sensitive to low interest rates. In fact, the current valuations have low interest in future as an embedded portion. And I can visualize that market can deal with 2-3 quarters of lost output and enhanced credit cost and losses for some period of time, but I don't think the markets are geared to have an era of high interest rate should the inflationary expectation arising out of monetary printing or supply shock realize in reality. Also, allocation of capital by corporates through the share buyback and healthy dividend, but through recourse to low leverage, has been a salient feature which has supported the high valuations in the recent decade since global financial crisis. Also, significant role of interest rate, and when I say interest rates, it's real interest rates. So if you see the graph on the right hand side, real interest rates which are extremely negative or high inflationary rates, both don't support high valuation, and in fact they support asset prices of value of store like gold, which I'm going to discuss going ahead. Now come back to the current situation. Arrival of serious health pandemic for which we have no clear treatment or vaccination plan has resulted into a serious dislocation of economy, resulting into synchronized stoppage of global economy, a demand and a supply shock, for which there is no clear-cut answers as of right now. Let's just visualize the lessons of past are something which is not worth forgetting. So if you see, there have been several health pandemic which have occurred in the past, which had far more fatality rate than current one. But what has made this crisis unique to us is the synchronized global stoppage of economy. And to highlight this, let's go back to year 1906. The world was facing an onslaught of typhoid and no antibiotics were discovered at that point of time. There was an immigrant called Mary Mellon who had immigrated from Ireland to USA and had taken a job in wealthy household of New York to serve as a cook. She was the first known case of an healthy, asymptomatic carrier who was primarily healthy, showing no symptom, and yet was transmitting typhoid, as later on was discovered by the health authorities of that time. It was only in 1902 that a concept that an asymptomatic carrier could be spreading a contagious disease was discovered by scientist Robert Koch. And it was in 1906 they could trace that this particular lady who became famous in the history as Typhoid Mary was responsible for spreading the contagious disease to lot of healthy and wealthy household in New York. They quarantined her for 3 years, and following which she appealed to the Supreme Court and she was released. She was ordered not to serve the community, but yet she managed to overrule that and was in fact found working as a cook in Sloan Maternity Hospital, where again she was found spreading typhoid in as late as 1915. And since she violated it, she was quarantined for almost 26 years of her life. So with this kind of background, what I wanted to highlight is humankind has faced many a pandemic and has eventually found a cure for it. And I hope that this time is no different. To summarize, we have a highly contagious global pandemic, which has resulted into an economic stoppage in an era of low interest rate cycle and high debt. And this has resulted into volatile investor psychology, which is manifesting into high volatility in asset prices across the world and across the asset classes. I wanted to share with you a framework of visualizing the investing scenario in the post-COVID situation. For you to do that, you will have to visualize this pandemic from vantage point of a virologist and the medical healthcare facility providers, from that of consumer, from a that of business owner, and a that of a policy regulator who has a micro view, to the view of asset markets, and to understand how the assets market has reacted to the fast surge crisis. I would urge you to go to an earlier presentation of mine, which is hosted on the CFA website, which deals with the extremes of bubbles and crashes, which have happened in the past, and lays a framework of spotting them and laying out a playbook to navigating your investment portfolio during that time. A primer on positioning your portfolio during the time of extreme dislocation. One thing that becomes very clear is that when the range of outcome is too wide and timelines are too uncertain, cognitive overload happens and processing the information rationally and probabilistically becomes almost impossible for most of the market participants. Hence, conviction to commit capital diminishes dramatically, and in such times, value of store like cash and gold becomes sensible option, even if you have a conviction on a particular outcome from a range of wide outcomes. Larger the range of probable outcomes and many uncertain moving parts and hard to process unknown unknown, lesser and lesser it will be possible for an investor to be sure about their particular view on the outcome going ahead. So when I visualize this pandemic from a biological and medical service provider fraternity, there are too many variables. The efficacy of testing kit, the fatality rate, the infection rate, how do you reduce the half-life time, how do you keep supply chain going, how do you find vaccines, how do you find R&D spend going, how do you have mass manufacturing in place. When all this kind of divergent unknowns come together, there is a full likelihood of policy errors. And obviously, in such times, policy undershoot and overshoot happen, and people tend to err on the side of caution. If you look at from consumer standpoint, it's the same thing repeated. Human beings are social animals, but they are living in isolation right now. Issues of liberty are coming to the fore. Issue of livelihood are also coming forward, but I think so the issues of human life takes precedence over this. There are psychological related moving parts, and there are financial related moving parts. If you look at from corporate business viewpoint, an operating manager has to take a lot of corrective action, has to plan for business continuity, has to look at internal and external view and an investor view, and yet maintain its competitiveness by a prudent capital allocation strategy. If you look at a global macro view, the policy decision makers have to worry about who's going to fund for the fiscal stimulus, what would be the impact of monetary printing, what would be the impact of demand shrinkage, what would be the impact of high debt, and what would be the impact on currency and exchange rate and so on and so forth. So from every vantage point, there are too many moving parts, and consequence of consequences need to be borne in mind, which are not so easy to visualize at this stage. From an asset market perspective, if you look at equity markets, equity markets have the worst risk reward scenario right now from all perspective. And I'll be coming to it in the later part of the presentation. So the default setting of investor is going back to the human bias. As a primitive, we were forced to think of either fight or flight. And currently, since we are unable to fight the pandemic, we have chosen the easy way of taking the flight to safety. Safe haven investment have low yields right now and a high implicit cost of safety embedded in them. And more uncertain investment have higher yields, but high implicit returns potential embedded in it. And consequently, if you see, gold is the only asset class which has delivered positive returns since this calendar year. Also, there is a major ring of moral hazard where the decision makers and the regulators and the authorities don't want to be seen as a person who erred and then be called out by names. Duration of investment horizon and stability of capital and temperament therefore should matter, because longer this virus and longer the responsive stoppage of economy, the worse will be the human and economic consequences. Some of the moral hazard can be zombie companies which might stay alive, or government may end up giving liquidity to people or entities which don't need them, and then later on find that there was no free lunch and eventually somebody will have to pay a higher price. Higher taxes and regulation are therefore inevitable, in my opinion, going ahead. Coming back to, there's a lot of discussion on the precedence of the past and the current episode. And the easiest one, which closely resembles to this time frame, is a situation of two decades which happened in 1910 and 1930, where there was a Spanish pandemic flu and there was a severe crisis and recession which followed. However, as Tolstoy said, there are some nuances which are different this time. So just to put things in perspective, I have put out a slide where we have compared the Great Depression of 1930s with the Great Recession of 2008 and the current Great Lockdown. While it's very clear that the current ongoing recession is not anywhere serious to the Great Depression, it has all the hallmark of becoming one should the longevity of this pandemic continue due to exponential spread. Secondly, the two big important factors are the policy levers available to the authorities to address this crisis are not present, in the sense that even in Great Depression of 1930, the interest rates were quite high. In fact, one of the reasons why the Great Depression got compounded was because interest actually rose from 4.5% to 6%, and there were fiscal austerity measures taken by government to balance the book, which is not the situation right now. To give you a statistical, empirically relevant data points, the global the US GDP to debt was barely 170% versus more than 380% right now, and the interest rates, which are today floor, were almost in the region of 4.5 to 5%, and unemployment rate during 1928 to 1930 period was far higher and far more sticky. Coming back to the process, what do we do in this current environment? My view is asset prices are socially distancing themselves from ground reality. And as an investor, we would be better served if we worry top down, but build our portfolio from bottoms up. Equity investors need to be aware of dangers which are happening in fixed income and high yield markets in India and abroad. And given this situation, I think so cash has a tremendous call option value till the semblance of narrow probable outcomes manifest themselves. Also, investors would be better served if they can hedge their portfolio with cheap hedges or insurance. Currently, when I look back to think about the kind of investment opportunities in equities market today, I would be looking for avoiding all the fragile companies which might have survival issues or might become value traps. and focus on companies which are robust and resilient. And ideally, be lucky enough if you could find an anti-fragile company which actually thrives in an era of chaos. So many of these digital platforms, which we are all regular users of, have actually thrived in the era of low-touch human economy, because most of their delivering of service happens virtually and their incremental cost of distributions are very low. So ideally, if you could latch on to such anti-fragile companies which gain market share from other players during such time, those companies should be heftily added in your portfolio at this stage. Let me illustrate this further. From an investor viewpoint, anti-fragile companies give you an optionality which is highly valuable, because longevity of growth of this optionality is very high, and such companies are highly rare to find. So if I have to construct a portfolio, I would want to avoid companies which are neither resilient nor optional, or purely only optionality, because pure optionality company may not have cash flow to survive through this turbulent time. So I would be focused more on the column 1 and 2 kind of companies and make a core portfolio out of that at this stage. Again, I hate myself for saying so. I have not been a great proponent of gold. I always found it to be an unproductive asset, but it's a currency of God. Central bankers can't print it. It has a very low correlation to other asset classes. It has proven itself as a value of store. And though yields are very low and prices are very high, I think so in an era where there could be low real interest rates or a slight probability of inflation going ahead, gold would be well served in an investor's portfolio. And rightly so, gold has been outperforming all other classes in recent times. Also, equity investors should be worried about high yield bonds. So I've given examples of some of the large companies whose yield, the debt is yielding equity-like return in dollar terms, and also equity-like returns in local market. So the question then one asks is, why would you invest in equities if the bonds are yielding such high returns? Also, there is extreme polarization of market, where very narrow band of companies are contributing to large asset allocation and also large outperformance. A case in point would be the tech companies in USA, where Microsoft and FANG have almost outperformed, and if you remove them, the rest of the index has not done well. Similarly, the situation out here, that if you remove the top 15 stock, Indian indices also have not done well. And the reasons are twofold. Obviously, companies which are larger economies of scale and access to the capital, which makes them structurally advantaged. But also the fact that in capital markets, there is an extreme move towards indexing, and many of the mutual funds are also closet indexer. So purchasing the shares of company which are showing this leadership has almost become a fashion, irrespective of the valuation. And this is going to be a very extreme point of discomfort for value investor like me. Also, I would like to highlight that many companies talk about their culture, and many investors talk that culture is the secret source which enables the longevity and compounding. But if you really see, many of the companies are talking win-win but practicing win-lose. So let's look at an example. So Boeing distributed 74% of its free cash flow in stock purchases. It cut costs to brutally please the investors, but resulted into failure of the 737 MAX. And then company had to resort to bailouts at a very high yield. In India also, we have seen many companies donate generously to government initiatives, but have not extended the same courtesy to their vendors or their landlords. It gives you a feeling that probably they are talking win-lose. And one should bear this aspect of investing also in mind. Friends, I think the time is running out. I'm not going to talk too much about this source, but There are lots of additional resources available on the net where I've selected few of the books where I've taken some of the data points from, and you could take some of them for further reading on how pandemics have evolved, how pandemics influence the economy of the system, when they happened and how they were overcome, and how human ingenuity eventually prevailed. I would also urge you to read these two books. One is Against the God by Peter Bernstein, which deals with not the pandemic, but risk management. Investment is the art of managing risk, not the return. Also, Annie Duke's book on thinking in bets is a very worthwhile reading that highlights one thing, that even if the event has very low probability, low frequency, but high impact, then it can't be ignored by investors, because sometimes those events come to the fore, as Taleb says, black swan events do arise. And then the investor needs to be positioned to withstand them. With this, I will conclude my presentation, and we can have question and answer now.
Thank you, Kulthip Bhai. That was a great presentation. There are quite a few questions that we can take up, but I would just like to first ask a question from my side. You know, when you open the newspapers today, or you go to your phones or tablets and read the news that's all around, I'm sure everyone feels depressed and there's no good news coming out. What is one mind hack that you can, you know, tell participants that they can use to view the situation very objectively instead of getting just one-sided views that you read in paper?
Very interesting question. I think that this is burning question uppermost in the minds of almost all investors, especially in this pandemic era, which is first modern pandemic happening in the time of social media, where there is an amplification of bad news and the news travels fast in literally matter of minutes. This is leading to a great amount of information overload, I think so. And I think so, human brains are not geared to process the frequency and the amount of information which is coming through actually. So I think so, investor would be best served, first of all, by taking a very honest view of their own investing time horizon and their temperament to absorb volatility at this stage, and hence create adequate cushion for meeting their lifestyle needs and having adequate buffer to be buyers and not sellers of the assets at the prices which don't make sense. So while hypothetically it's easy to do a DCF and say a couple of quarters or even 1-2 years of earnings don't materialize in an era of low interest rate and high terminal value being the biggest driver of the valuation, I would ride it out. But when actually the drawdowns happen, they are psychologically leaving a very different kind of scar. So you've got to make up your mind whether it's a fear of greed or a fear of missing the opportunity or fear of losing capital, which is giving you more pain. And I think so, one has to then take a very meaningful call and position a portfolio for a much more longer period of time. Analyzing your portfolio on a real-time basis, on a day-to-day basis, I don't think so is going to be counterproductive. Because till the time there is a definitive end in horizon, I think so, the range of outcomes is just seriously hard. But let me tell you, what is the certainty that this won't be a start-stop economy? Because there is a full probability that this virus could mutate and could have a secondary wave which is far more infectious and deadlier than the first wave. So I think so, one has to be aware of the wide range of outcomes and be content to take calls once there is a narrower of, you know, the probabilities and the narrower of, you know, the optionalities you have, you see for save the time. I don't see any other way, because for investor to be able to commit capital, you have to analyze large amount of information and then focus on 2 or 3 critical parts. But right now, the number of critical parts are just too high, Jitendra. And that's why you see very wide range of opinion of some of the best masters in the pre-period of this investment. In fact, if you ask me, in my almost 30 years of career, this is the worst time I am facing. To be able to take a definitive mind map of, you know, where I'm positioned. And in fact, there are days where I feel, you know, valuations are becoming very juicy. A lot of mid caps are operating cheaply. And there are days where I feel that, you know, the worst is yet to come. So volatility in thinking is there. And one should, you know, take a very calibrated stance after only this volatility dies down in mind and as well as in asset market.
Right. So something of a similar question that somebody asked, that is this a high uncertainty and high risk sort of a market or scenario, or are we just looking at high uncertainty? I mean, can you even define risk at this moment?
So, Jitendra, in past, if you see all the crises have either come from a banking crisis where there was overlending, or an asset crisis where particular asset became in vogue, like telecom stock or mortgages and so on and so forth. Here you have two big things happening at the same time. There has been a pandemic which is creating havoc with human life. There could be a scenario where, you know, the hospital capacity infrastructure may not be able to give treatment to all the people needing it. And that gives you a sense of helplessness. Also, there is actually a synchronized stoppage of global economy. It has not ever happened in the past. We had world wars, we had every kind of crisis, but I don't recall a crisis which can spread so quickly. Like through airlines, you can transfer it literally thousands of kilometers away and start the infection process. And also, a stoppage of economy which gives you uncertainty about your cash flows, about your asset collateral. So to that extent, it's overwhelming. I would say till the health side is not taken out, I think so volatility is going to be around the corner, because nobody with seriousness can tell you, okay, this is the bottom or this is the top. And there would be volatility in thinking as the epidemic progresses. I think this is inevitable. Till the time we don't have clarity on the duration of the pandemic, its impact, how deep it is and how long it is, I think so range of outcomes, I keep telling, is so wide. It's overwhelming some of the best investors. That's why you see Warren Buffett not investing in spite of sitting on cash. You have Stanley Druckenmiller coming and saying it's bad. You have a whole host of investors which are far more accomplished than people like me, not able to make up their mind, and then who am I to take a definitive call? So positioning your portfolio to handle a very low prices is a must, I think so, in this moment.
You mentioned Buffett. I think this is the first time he sold stocks in a crash, so that's also a different design. Well, you know, we have so much of uncertainty, but there are participants asking, and I myself wanted to ask, there is this disconnect between the economy and the market. You had a very bad month of March, probably the worst ever, and then in April you had this huge turnaround, more so in the US market. You've covered more than half of the lost ground, in fact, much more so in US. So mostly people, when they say, look at the market and then look at the news, there is some sort of a dissonance which it causes. How do you explain that? Is it the Fed which is cushioning the market? If that is the case, are investors asking for a very, very, very low risk premium? And if I extend that further, will that mean that going forward, we are entering an era of low equity returns?
So two things. If you can predict successfully what is going to be the interest rate going ahead, then probably you could answer quite a lot of this question. But let me just step back. The markets today are made up of investors with very different time horizons. So there could be algorithms trading for a day to investors like pensioning and index fund, which might be taking a 20-year view, to managements who are taking much more longer view, to index fund which have no view and are price insensitive buyers. So there is a heady cocktail of investors with expecting different things from the same asset class. So obviously there's going to be bout of volatility. So every rise will be sold into and every dips will be bought. That's, I think, so given the fundamental construct of the market. And so hence I mentioned in my presentation that longevity of your capital and the stability of your capital as well as your mindset is something which needs to be upfront on the table. If that is doubtful, then you will be whipsawed by this market and this volatility. Going specifically into the nitty-gritty, each markets and each asset classes have their own nuances. Like oil, it was a technical shortage of storage which resulted into such abnormal pricing on the derivatives market. So one has to be very cognizant of the interplay of technical and the fact that there are all kinds of market participants. So one should not be driven by this volatility, and one can only be allowing one's own view to prevail by patiently waiting for your prices of both buying and selling to come. I think so, till the time this pandemic doesn't have an end game, and virus will define its end game, and human ingenuity in terms of R&D will determine it. I think so, this bout of volatility will be considered. And even if Fed stimulus begins to dominate the narrative, it's just a matter of time that people will ask the question, then what? Who is going to pay for it? How is this fiscal stimulus going to be impacting the inflationary expectation embedded? So that's why today you have bond investors who are worried about recession because of the debt overhang, and you have gold investors who are saying inflation is just around the corner. So you have contradictions bundled into current market, and one will have to learn to deal with these contradictions in a very calm and calibrated manner.
There's another question on what are the learnings from China went through their initial bout of infections and then kind of went through lockdown, and our news which you read that they have opened up the economy now, and the new stories on Disney parks getting oversold and Carnival cruises getting bought. So are there any learnings from there? I mean, even though I'm sure they're treading a very careful path, but are there any learnings for us from their experience?
Definitely, there are quite a lot of learning. I think so. How regulators share the information rightfully and share the data at right time is one big learning. I think so. In this pandemic episode, I think so, we were unprepared, and data sharing has not been timely and meaningfully relevant enough to, you know, prevent the onslaught of this pandemic. Secondly, China, because of its resources at its disposal and the way the society is geared up, have been able to exercise a far more disciplined route to containing the virus, which I think so many of the other economies, because of the way their society is structured, will not be able to execute. So playbook of China to an extent will not be possible to repeat in other democratic form of government. And I think so, containment and the timely action, I think so, the speed. See, even if you err on the side of wrong, you can't err on the side of not taking an action. I think so, containment has been policy of many pandemics in the past. It has been highly documented, and more so in this era of global travel. So containing micro clusters, I think so, is a very is a must, in fact. And while we discuss about getting the economy back to this normalcy, one has to be very aware that we keep the spread to a manageable level so that our hospital infrastructure is not overwhelmed.
There are questions on investment opportunities. I mean, you kind of explained somehow that you're looking for anti-fragile companies. Which are the companies you think will survive this, in fact, will thrive? You can give some sort of examples, not from maybe current instance, but from the past. Any sort of contrarian opportunities that you're looking forward
to? So, Jitendra, if you look at it, let's focus on what will not change. While we don't know what is going to change, and it's very clear to me right now that a lot of things have changed in short term. And many things will have to be changed in about our lifestyle and our consumption pattern in medium term. But in long term, I think so, human ingenuity will prevail and we'll go back to our societal way of, you know, interaction and doing the business. So one thing to find is, you know, invert the problem and ask ourselves question, okay, what makes company fragile during this time? So high leverage would be one such. Concentration of clients in one location, concentration of supply chain in one side. There are a whole host of parameters which would bring out the fragility of an organization, and those kind of organizations have to be avoided. Also, right now is the time of plenty. You have haves and have nots. So there are some companies which are priced to perfection, because many of the investors who have this question, okay, today I buy Johnson & Johnson and a Nestle yielding me 2% dividend yield and a far higher earning yield with a growth optionality, or do I buy US government bond where my risk is very high, but my returns are capped? So there is a lot of movement of capital across asset classes. So investors who are married to an asset class would have a problem, but investors whose mandate permit them to move across asset class have far higher degree of flexibility. Having said that, since we are talking to predominantly an equity investor base of our audience, I think so, one should look at what happens after 2 years. So one should take a pause and step back. Okay, what are the things which are not going to change? And where there is a zone of safety in terms of valuation? Because what is perceived to be highly safe right now can be highly counterproductive in terms of return. So I'll give you a narrative. Okay, I'm not to say that I'm recommending something, but give you a narrative. So today, even within a subsector, let's say financials, people are blindly, very risk averse to levered financials, but highly embracing the distribution companies like insurance AMC. But when you bring the price to the equation, you would realize that the margin of safety probably lies in financials which are levered, because probably few out of them will emerge from a very low competitive advantage, means competitive environment, and their price point at which they are available, probably they might be better risk reward return. So one has to go against the narrative and look, okay, are you paying a very high price of that rosy certainty? And since the future returns are a function of current price paid, one has to be, see, please understand, many of the asset class investors would sell off very quickly, but long-term investors who are married to a particular ideology of a particular ideology would have a plus point. So let me give you one contrast example. Today in commodities, we know we can't deal without commodities. In commodities, the last man standing with lowest cost of production and the access to capital markets via lower leverage would eventually win and would have a very far more upside than a probably a very safe company which is already you paid the price set before. So it all boils down to one's choice architecture and what one can sleep well at night. And it's very, very, very unique from investors' propensity to overpay for quality or bear uncertainty but be compensated by lower price.
Okay. You mentioned about investors kind of should look at different asset classes, and there also you mentioned gold, right? So there are investors friends who wonder whether there are other asset classes.
So Jitendra, I think so. I lost you for a minute, but your question was the cross asset classes investing and the need to look at other asset classes.
Are we still connected?
So my hypothesis is, let's give you a live example. If debt securities of a corporate are giving you equity like return, why would you look at equity? ultimately you have to counterbalance your return and your risk profile. Many times investors which are acting in silos are not aware of far lesser risk, more rewarding opportunities which are emerging in the periphery. So just to give you an example, today the dollar bonds of some of our financials are giving equity like returns because of the dislocation and the flight to safety. So I think so the flexibility to invest across asset class is a desirable one, and I am cognizant of the fact many of us don't have it. For the investors we don't have, I think so positioning ourselves from cash and the defensiveness are the only two options. Jitendra?
Yeah. From a personal perspective, or has that continued to be the same?
Jitendra, I think so. I missed your question because of some internet connectivity. Can you repeat the question?
So there are questions on how you have designed your portfolio during.
Jitendra, sorry, I'm having connectivity issue.
Is that clear?
Yeah, I think so. It's much clearer. Thank you.
So the question is: have you also realigned your portfolio, or are you waiting going forward versus act now, or should they wait for clarity?
So personally, I have created sufficient cash, which allows me to take peaceful sleep and take advantage of the price fall if they happen, with a clear thing that should the stimulus and monetary easing prevail and the asset class again continue their onward journey, or suppose by chance a miracle, a vaccine or a treatment comes around, I'm ready to leave with the fear of missing out on the opportunities. Secondly, my currently focus is on identifying the companies which are gaining market share and are which are anti-fragile and they are not obvious. Thirdly, the way I position is I have included gold as a first time consideration. So yes, things are changing, and as I've been candid to admit, okay, this has been one of the most challenging time in my investment career. So I'm not taking decisions very quickly. I'm slipping over it, and I think so I'm processing much more information, and I'm seeking out to seniors' opinion before doing anything, because many a times I think so they have seen much more or are more intelligent to me, and I think so this has helped me currently. Taking help of far more accomplished investors than me, I think so, is also helping, and I think so investors should do this.
Okay, we'll take just last two questions. In this entire scenario, are there any positives for India as a country or economy which we can kind of benefit from?
Chinese have a saying that never waste a crisis. And I think so, if you really actually look at it, our governments have gotten their act together at the time of crisis. I am very optimistic on our country, because I would remind you of Stockdale syndrome, where if you are an investor, you have to be cautiously optimistic, but at the same time be realistic about what can happen in short run. And I think so, apart from the near term issues of stimulus and getting the country back to the economic path of economic activity by dealing with a contagious pandemic, I think so we would be best served if we can take bold labor, land, laws, reform, especially on the legal side, because in India, legal system is not functioning and financial system is also a contract. Many times, the sanctity of this contract is not enforced in right point of time. So if we can get our act together on attracting investment and making the business environment more conducive for productivity, growth, and corporate activities, I think so we'll be very well served going ahead. Because I think so at some point of time, with the collective focus of world focused on solving this crisis, pandemic crisis, is my thinking about that.
Okay, great. Any last words of advice that you would like to give to our participants? We are running out of time. So anything which you think they should be doing, anything they should be thinking, what should be they focusing on, any advice you would like to give?
So in passing, I would say big results are driven by tail events like this. This is one of the rare events which is unfolding in front of eyes. So piece of advice I have is, don't buy a security till you don't fully understand what debt market is thinking about it, and vice versa. Debt guy should not buy unless what equity market is thinking about it. Also, nobody knows how and when this will end. And in interim, supply of paper can rise and capital calls can come in at unsuitable time. So one has to be even prepared for that. Till the effective vaccine or treatment is not found, there is a distinct possibility of very adverse scenarios also playing out. And I think so, if history is any guide, decision we take now, both the regulators, corporate and investors, will reverberate for quite some time to come, given the severity of dislocation which is happening right now. So erring on the side of caution might look foolish in the end, but I think so that's a price worth paying for at this stage.
Okay. Thank you so much, Kuntal. That was an amazing presentation. I would like to thank you for this, taking this time out and sharing your nuggets of wisdom. And I would like to thank all participants who joined us today. The presentation link has been shared with you in the chat. I'm sure most of you would have taken the survey, the poll, which is there on screen. If you haven't, please do it right away. And I would like to end this session with a quote which Howard Marks shared in his latest memo. It's by Ian Wilson, who was former chairman of GE. No amount of sophistication is going to allay the fact that all of our knowledge is about the past and all your decisions are about the future. Let's hope for a clearer future. Let's hope that our learnings from past kind of help us in solving this crisis and moving on ahead. Thank you so much, Kuntal. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Pleasure was mine.